afternoon. I'm really thankful to have the chance to be here with you today and having the honor of sharing this interesting discussion among Pakistani people. I would thank to Amna Malek and Tezin Nizar that gave me such an important opportunity. Today, my speech on some points about Kashmir situation and the human rights violation in that region. It has been 1 year since Kashmir remained in total lockdown. Narendra Modi, the flag carrier of the right-wing BJP, has called an outright damage to the Indian secular tradition. Amit Shah, the Indian Interior Minister, announced the approval of the presidential decree revoking the autonomies of to the areas of Jammu and Kashmir, granted by Articles 370 and 35A of the Indian Constitution, thereby cancelling the autonomy of Kashmir and changing definitely the basic rights of the Kashmiri people. After the August 2019, the Kashmir was cut off from the rest of India with no access to media information, including internet and telecommunication. Furthermore, the COVID-19 emergencies added fuel to the fire because India government has used instrumentally the tragic consequences of the pandemic to justify acts of brutality and violence. Kashmir is the largest Muslim majority province in India, and the ongoing conflict in Jammu and Kashmir is the oldest unresolved conflict under United Nations. The Partition of Act established that the areas with the Muslim majority belong to Pakistan, while those with the Hindu majority to India. Contrary to the Act of Division, India occupied other Muslim majority areas such as Junagadh and Hyderabad. But going back to the partition time, the Muslim of the India subcontinent believed that the dream of separate Muslim state could turn their fortunes. And when Pakistan was born, the dream seems to be realized. But the partition opened many questions that still today there are not adequate political answers. Because when it took place, this Muslim majority area did not become part of Pakistan, but on the contrary, became an unfinished agenda of the partition. Even since then, the constant acts of violence in Kashmir, which has effectively deprived the Muslim majority of the right to national self-determination, continue to be a crucial political knot between Pakistan and India. But the present India government has taken dangerous political initiatives that are causing this antagonism to grow even more. The Pulmana terrorist attack in February 14, 2019, and the Indian airstrike in Balakot some days later marks a dangerous new chapter in relations between the two countries. Peace supporters immediately asked to find a diplomatic solution, while the war merchants were ready to exploit the situation. Many Indian media pushed to a narrative able to exacerbate rhetoric about war. And few months later, on the 5th of August, the Kashmir self-determination were removed, and the arrival of around 900,000 Indian military made the region the most militarized zone in the world. The articles I mentioned before allow the province to preserve its cultural despite being in the center of the Hindu world. Their repeal deprived actually the Muslim population of many rights, and the clashes between military and civilians has provoked hundreds of deaths, and dozens of activists and politicians were arrested, increasing the risk of geopolitical instability in all region. This lockdown targeted millions of people who are prisoners in their homes. From a certain point of view, we could compare Palestine and Gaza with Kashmir. India sees Kashmir as a Hindu territory that has been lost and should be taken back. De facto abrogation of the Article 35 is giving the possibility to create a settlement policy similar to Israel. But while the human rights abuses in conflicts like Palestine has garnered global attention, The same thing did not happen for Kashmiri people. Kashmir now is a place where children cannot go to school, people cannot go to work or walking freely in the streets. This means the end of human rights and humanity in a country which everyone was proud of their diversity tradition. The crackdown sparked international criticism. Angela Merkel, the German leader, officially said that the situation in Kashmir is not sustainable. And also United Nations has stressed the attention on the latest restriction imposed on India-administered Kashmir that will exacerbate the human rights situation. Moreover, the access to the area for foreign observers, including diplomats, humanitarian groups, and journalists, is strictly controlled. No reporters were allowed access to the area to follow the August 19 protests. Even now, foreign envoys are being given police escort, apparently for their own safety, and rarely obtain permission to travel outside the main city of Srinagar. India accuses Pakistan of training and sending militants across the border to launch a terroristic attack and fuel the growth of a separatist movement against Indian rule. India surely is trying to give a negative image of Pakistan at international level, but it could not not succeed in its ambitions. In fact, Prime Minister Imran Khan condemned the New Delhi political choice, calling it contrary to the 1972 Shimla agreements, according to which the territorial dispute between the two states should have been resolved peacefully. Khan feared the risk of bloodbath and escalation of the conflict. For this reason, during the UN General Assembly, which took place in September 2019, the Pakistan Prime Minister warns of potential nuclear war over Kashmir. Moreover, he underlined the necessity of the UN intervention in order to avoid a war between Delhi and Islamabad, which would leave consequences not only for Pakistan and India, but also for the region and for the entire world. He urged an international forum to take action for solving Kashmir dispute, and most of all, for giving the people of Kashmir the right of self-determination, which is their fundamental right. While Islamabad clearly shows its concern about Kashmir situation, giving a positive sign to internationalize these issues, New Delhi has given another perspective, because India government considered the Kashmir situation an internal matter and between Pakistan and India only. Kashmir situation has always been complicated, but under Modi's presidency, things getting worse day by day. Now its Hindutva agenda is no more a secret. It contains elements of Russia's supremacy, and the goal is pushing India into an authoritarian Hindu nationalist state. The Bharatiya Janata Party, currently in power in India, gained control of key government institutions. BJP was born from the ashes of Bharatiya Janata Sangh Party, an ultra-national organization founded in 1951. The Ahmadabad revolt in Gujarat in 2002, it is an emblematic example of its ideology, and many political experts believe it was born out of the political will of the current Prime Minister of India. During the last election campaign, Modi has strategically chosen to increase war hysteria against Pakistan. The anti-Muslim and anti-minority feelings has reached a dangerous level in a country that has been always considered the largest democracy in the world. We even stress the attention on India's free press, which has always played a crucial role in protecting this country since its independence from Britain in 1947. Since Modi came to power in 2014, his government has tried to control the country's new media, and Indian journalists here now feel themselves under attack. According to Al Jazeera, 29 arrests of activists occurred in 2016, many of them in Kashmir. And after Burhan Wani killing, the 22 years old commander of the separatist group of Kashmir, Hizbul Mujahideen, in July 8, 2016, there were protests for several months across Kashmir, in which over 100 civilians were killed and 12,000 people were injured. Now we have to put aside for a moment Kashmir's situation and try to understand the success of a leader of an ultra-nationalist party, because it was the vote of non-Hindu Indians that allowed Modi to remain firmly in power. In 2014, few experts understood that India had opened the doors to populism. In reality, Modi's popularity and success came from the invisible social class that no longer felt represented by the political elite of Congress, which is involved in corruption scandals, and now far from the needs of the people. Narendra Modi has turned his political attention towards those parts of India population who live in the villages and or slums. These millions of people in need of any kind of assistance have heard for the first time after years a politician who turned directly to them, obtained at least part of them, toilets, electricity, gas connection, faster and easier access to bank loans. Furthermore, the political and military comparison with Pakistan, manipulated by Modi before the start of the electoral race, has been able to regain the hearts of millions of Indians by giving them back a long-forgotten national pride. For the first time, millions of Indians of all ages, social and cultural groups, have no longer felt beggars at the gates of so-called Western paradise, a citizen with rights and duties identical to those of the rest of the world. Going back to Kashmir human rights violation, children are surely those who are paying the highest price, and one of the direct impacts of large-scale militarization in Jammu and Kashmir has been on the education of children, as hundreds of schools were converted into military camps. The occupation of school by armed forces create a situation of insecurity and fear among students. The data reveals that children have also become victims of enforced disappearance by the hand of armed forces during the three-decade-long armed conflict in Jammu and Kashmir. Kashmiri women are also victims, and threat of violence against them is rising, as well as the rape, which is frequently used as a weapon. Nowadays, it's impossible to find a precise estimate about rapes and the number of widows and women whose husbands have been disappeared or killed by Indian forces. The paternalistic tones of Modi's rhetoric agenda show clearly the fundamentally misogynist side of BJP politics. Kashmiri women ended up at the center of the salvific mission of Modi government, described as unarmed victims of the Islamic patriarchate. Misogyny and paternalism are therefore non-incidental, but constitutive of the nationalist aspiration of the Modi government. The Indian women narrative as an act of liberation against Islamic oppression. This is often overlooked by political analysts. However, neglecting it means to do not understand, as the control of women's bodies corresponds to a specific project of nationalist Modi's agenda in order to weaken politically both people of Kashmir and India Muslim. But all Kashmir people are victims, and they have witnessed violation of human rights in the form of extrajudicial execution, injuries, illegal detention, torture, sexual violence, arson and vandalism of civil properties, restriction on religious activities, media gags, and ban on communication and internet services. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights prohibits torture and other forms of cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. The government of India has ratified the ICCPR and the fourth Geneva Convention of 1949. The Article 3 of the Geneva Convention, which applies to international internal conflicts, prohibits murder, torture of non-combatants by both government and militant forces. The Armed Forces Special Powers Act, AFSPA, the law that grants special powers to security forces, is a major obstacle to the responsibility of the armed forces, as it provides effective immunity for human rights violation. Since the law entered into force in Kashmir in 1990, the India government has not allowed security forces to be prosecuted in civil courts for the crimes they committed, said Human Rights Watch. In 2018, UN Human Rights Commission published a report identifying many human rights abuses committed by India Army, but India strongly rejected the findings of the report, declaring it to be fallacious, prejudice, and violation of its sovereignty and territorial integrity. According to the data of Association of Parents of Disappeared Persons and Jammu Kashmir Coalition of Civil Society, a total of 4,000 people have been killed between 2008 and 2018 in Jammu and Kashmir. 1,070 were civilians, and more than 8,000 people have been subjected to enforced or involuntary disappearances since 1990. In July 2019, a report of UN High Commission of Human Rights underlined the concern about abuses in Kashmir. The report documented human rights violations by India security forces, including extrajudicial killings, arbitrary detention, and forced disappearance. Even in this case, the India government dismissed the report as a false and motivated narrative that ignore the core issue of cross-border terrorists. The terrorist topic is always used by New Delhi to justify the attacks in Kashmir. In conclusion, India and Pakistan have opposite perspective on Kashmir issues. Nowadays, the possibility of India-Pakistan dialogue is very difficult, considering the present political situation. The relation between the two countries had never been so tense for years, and Modi narrative is deeply increasing the Hindu-Muslim antagonism. International media seem not to be interested in what is happening in Kashmir, undervaluing the risk of war in that region, which could have dramatic local and global consequences. The biggest danger is that a conventional war could escalate in a nuclear confrontation, and the military clash could be in Kashmir. Worldwide attention must remain on the atrocity and violation of human rights that people of Kashmir suffer every day, because what is happening in that region is no longer humanly tolerable. There is a need of the international community to recognize the severe threat of genocide and bloodbath once the curfew is lifted. In this context, Modi should be complicit of war crimes against his own population and be brought under the International Criminal Court. It's also a responsibility of the international community to acknowledge that the attention given to the plight of Kashmir people should get maximum possible coverage in the news media, both print and electronic. Civil societies, NGOs, and voices should be pulled their resources to gather the voices, both official and non-official, for support and solidarity with the Kashmiris before it will be too late. Thank you very much.